know, because the world is like an animated place, and often things, and you're moving in it at least, or it's moving around you, and you make sense of things, I think, in a very different way.
Grenville Davey's sculpture is particularly interesting because at once it refers to objects in an everyday world, objects that we are quite familiar with, not particularly special objects, objects that you might see in the corner of your eye. At the same time, they refer to an artistic tradition, 20th century tradition of the ready-made, where objects from the everyday world are placed in an art context, a gallery. For example, Third Eye looks like it might slot into place on the deck of a boat, or it may be the covering for the end of a pipe or something like that. But then there are little details that start to confound your vision of the work in that way. Little details that, I mean, when you start to think about it, you realize that it just doesn't fit, and then the work becomes incongruous and you realize that something more complicated is going on.
I don't expect anyone to go out after seeing some of my work and have a totally different view of the world. I want people to enjoy and understand the way the work concretely exists. It doesn't belong in the world, it's part of it.
If you're working as an artist in Britain at the moment, it's quite hard to operate only within your own country. It's very important to get outside and to be involved in dialogue with other artists, other people, galleries, curators. Grenville, right from the beginning, made it his business to get out of the country and to travel and to get his work seen elsewhere.
It's crucial that his work reminds us of objects in the everyday world. I mean, it makes the work accessible. It makes the work interesting for the audience. It also creates this teasing relationship placed in an art context, say a gallery or a museum. It refers to this, if you like, traveling from a space beyond the gallery into the gallery, and also encourages us, if you like, to travel imaginatively, to make links with our own experience. This whole question of associative thought, which I think is important for our understanding of his work.
I'm not denying any of those references. I'm just sort of saying that to me they're more like glands on the outside of something than you know, I mean, I only say that because they have no reflective surface, and it would be an absurd proposition, really, to say these are like mirrors, because generally they're like mirrors. They aren't like mirrors because they're non-reflective.
Although there's a surface resemblance to certain objects that we all know, there's also a connection with a sculptural tradition, certainly from work of the 60s, where artists were very optimistically using certain materials and structures to say something else about where their work might stand in relation to things. So a use of technologies, a use of materials and paint, the way the paint is applied, for example, directly refers to work by earlier British sculptors such as Philip King.
I think in a lot of early works, especially like Rail, I mean, it's an inroad into understanding how things kind of concretely exist, and you're supposed to be able to enjoy that process.
The fabrication of Grenville's work often involves other people. I mean, people working in factories, in metal foundries, producing, for example, the circular flanges that often occur in his work. Scale is very important in Grenville's work. It's not monumental. That is to say, it's not there simply to be looked at like monuments are. It has a user-friendly scale, a quality. It looks like you could pick it up, you could touch it, you could move it around. And this refers to the way he makes it, in fact. I mean, the way he moves the work around the studio. He's not using cranes, he's not using massive machines to manufacture this stuff. I mean, he's handling it in the studio, and the work looks like that, and it looks like we could handle it as well, that it might be very useful for us in some way. And yet, on the other hand, there are these details, these small reminders, if you like, that this is a work of art. And the work becomes a very, very complex statement about the relationship between art and utility.
Spinning is a process where you turn a flat sheet over a tool and reorder the structure of the material and take it over, say, a dome or a right angle edge. It means that you don't cut, you spin and you force the material around a shape on a thing that looks like a very big lathe. If it goes wrong, then it's like pastry, it flares, and they actually let it flare in a totally irregular way and then trimmed it. Reg Art was one of the first pieces that went through an engineer the right way. I'd asked them to fabricate something that, I mean, which would have ended up in a skip. They made a mistake, and they were quite willing to do it.
The allusion to functional objects in Grenville's work is obvious, and at the same time, that possibility that they might be useful is denied. In the later work, I mean, in most recent work, for example, Golden Table, the idea of its being a functional object is pushed to an extreme, only to be denied. I mean, the fact that it's made of wood, like tables are made of wood, but it's too high for you to use as a table. You can't put your legs underneath it, and that incongruity is crucial to our understanding of his work. What Grenville is saying about contemporary life is that it's extremely interesting, the smallest details, the things that you stumble across, things that you might not notice every day, that all of this can feed into the making of art and communicate it to an audience, and this subsequently enriches contemporary life.
It's more of an issue about the kind understanding, you know, if you do come across something that you feel is important, you do things about it. You make a record, you make a note, you describe it to yourself, you make sure it has some life, and you try and hang on to it